So you got to be a superhero on The Simpsons, of course. I got to be a bad guy. I don't know what this says about either of us. I got to be an illiterate bad guy on The Simpsons. I was an illiterate bad guy on The Simpsons.
Oh, I just got to say, Mouse is in the house.
Hello. So this is the first of a series of conversations where they've said that if I want, I can bring people I want to talk to up onto this stage and talk to them. And I've known Art now for about 25, 26 years. And in that time, whenever we get together, we talk. So I thought, if we just take this out of the kitchen and put it on the stage, that will work. We will talk. And then Art decided to bring his computer. So now
I gotta read all your blogs, man. I'm only up to 2008, you know.
So now we're gonna get to talk with occasional pictures. And so welcome. Thank you so much for coming out this evening. Art, how did you discover comics? Well, what were the first comics you ever read?
Well, the first comic I ever saw wasn't the first comic I ever read. It was a pile of Batman comics that came up in a bit of the conversation before we were mic'd and I had the computer with me. Because I was visiting the house next door where the kid was older than me. He was gone, but there was a pile of Batmans there while my mother was talking. While my mother was talking to the woman next door, I sat with this pile of Batman comics and they looked really sinister. And I just found them a little bit eerie. I must have been about 5 years old, I guess, or four and a half. And I just wanted to understand if he was a good guy or a bad guy. So I asked my mother, and she was, of course, clueless, because she was a refugee from Hitler's Europe and didn't know that much about Batman. So I'd have her just read a few panels, and like I was just trying to get a sense of it, and I understood that it was really urgent to be able to read the glyphs above the drawings in each box, because then I'd figure it out for myself, and it was an incentive to learn how to read. And ultimately, I guess, I certainly learned to read from Batman, but I learned about sex contemplating Betty and Veronica. On the other hand, feminism from Little Lulu. Economics from...
That's good.
The same as the Wall Street gonifs, actually. And philosophy from Peanuts, and politics from Pogo, and fucking near everything else from Mad Magazine. So the first comic I really learned to read and love was Mad. And we were actually before, you should have been with us all day, because then I wouldn't have to recap. But the thing is that both of us got imprinted by Mad in a certain way. So Neil was telling me about, so I met this guy and he was a Jack Kirby guy. And at first I thought that meant it was at a Comic Con and he was somebody who liked Jack Kirby and whatever. But then it turned out, no, he had blunt fingers and a barrel chest and was a dwarf with gigantism?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's the only time, if any of you have ever seen anything drawn by Jack Kirby, who was a wonderful artist who created most of what Marvel makes their monies out of in movies these days, came out of the fingers of Jack Kirby at some point. But he used to draw people who were sort of square. And they had fingers that looked like sausages with square ends. And they didn't actually look like people.
And it's twice as true for the women.
Well, the women didn't even look...
They looked like what you described, but with longer hair.
Yes. Very, very strange shapes. And they always had these huge jaws. But I actually once met, I met somebody, and I'm looking at him going, that is a Kirby character. He actually looks like he was drawn by Kirby. And I went over to him, and I said, look, I keep looking at you. And this is really weird, but I've never seen anybody like you before. What are you? And he was incredibly sweet and kind about it, and he explained that he was a dwarf with gigantism. He was the tallest dwarf in the world. He was about 5'9", 5'10", and he had the barrel chest of a dwarf. He was all, you know, physically he should have been about 3.5 feet tall, but he was a giant. And apparently that's what it takes to produce Jack Kirby characters.
But what it led to was the Mad Comics folks, the people who drew these books, were encouraged to draw like themselves, as opposed to try to find a house style and draw that way. And so I remember as a young person, whenever I'd be out in the world, like on a bus or in the subway, it's like, huh, that person's drawn by Jack Davis. Oh, there's a Wally Wood character walking by. And just figuring out who actually drew the person that now had appeared embodied in front of me. And then Neil went through his list of the same. And, oh yeah, that person I met that was like Bernie Wrightson drawing, or, and so on and so on, becomes a frame of reference. For me, though, Mad was specifically my gateway into the world. So it was like, MAD was an acronym for Mom and Dad, because I couldn't learn much from them. And so I got imprinted with a Mad Love. I saw her as soon as I walked into the store. It was love at first sight. In all my 7 years, I'd never seen anything like her. She was tiny, even smaller than my 5-foot-tall mom. She was about an inch high. She was a paperback cover girl, and she smelled of the illicit. I couldn't keep my hands off her. I knew my mother wouldn't approve, but I wanted her badly. I want this, Mommy. Absolutely not. She looked a bit like the Mona Lisa and a bit like those Picasso women I'd learned to love years later. But she was the meatball and spaghetti version. She was postmodernism, avant la lettre. She was beautiful. Mad warped a generation in the bland American 1950s. It was saying something new. It was saying the media, the whole damn adult world is lying to you. And we here at Mad are part of the media. But I want it, I need this. Okay, just don't tell Daddy I spent my grocery money on it. See, I studied Mad the way some kids studied the Talmud. Blankety blank for Schlugen or kid. So, like you, I discovered things a little after they were made, like the paperbacks were reprinting the comics, the same way you were discovering the comic books that shaped you when they were being reprinted in England in black and white.
It's true, and the same for me went with Mad. You know, I was discovering all of these Mad collections in England as I was 9, 10 years old, and what I didn't know is they were collecting as liberally from the original Mad comic as they were from Mad magazine. Mm. So you'd get the Mad Don Martin or the Mad movie parodies, but you'd also just get stuff where I'd get to read Super Duper Man or these weird comics that just sort of told you that you were, like you say, that you were being lied to. Except that they didn't take advertising, which always struck me.
In England?
No, they didn't.
Oh, they didn't.
That was always the thing about Mad.
That's when Mad died. They began to have... First thing they did was started telling you cigarettes were bad for you. And then they started sounding like parents. And then they started actually taking advertisements, though not from cigarette companies. And it changed the nature of it, because originally that cover launched an entire generation of underground comics artists. You know, because
that's
did
Basil
so much
Wolverton,
at once.
Isn't it?
That's a Basil Wolverton drawing collaged into a photo of the rooftops that one could get to through Mad's early comic book office windows on Lafayette Street near my place. And it also looked like Life magazine, which was the most authoritative source for all. It was like CNN and C-SPAN and the Al Jazeera network and all other sources of information embodied, and to have a lowly comic book that was looking exactly like a Life magazine cover and telling you that this is the beautiful girl of the month, saying ultimately that like André Breton said, beauty must be convulsive or it must not be. Finding a new definition of what's beautiful, and it worked on me.
Of course, Mad Magazine is one of the things that's fascinating for me about Mad is, on the one hand, we have EC Comics. EC Comics in the 1950s were doing all of the horror comics. That was good.
And we didn't even know we were going to use slides for sure till about an hour and a half ago.
This stuff was EC Comics, and when a very nice man, a very well-intentioned man, a relatively well-intentioned man, named Dr.
A complicated man.
A complicated man named Dr. Frederick Wertham. We used to sort of, the slack that I used to cut Frederick Wertham, who wrote a book called The Seduction of the Innocent, which proved that comics were out to destroy you by fostering teenage delinquency and juvenile delinquency and destroying your children. I used to cut him a little bit of slack, and then we discovered recently a researcher was going through Wertham's files and discovered that he actually faked a lot of his data, possibly all of his data.
He massaged it, they call it.
He massaged it.
But what he did that was interesting to me was, he was the demon for me when I was growing up, because he almost killed comic books. He got a wide forum for this notion that...
there was comics burning. I don't know what else
and
you've got
in
there.
Want pictures.
There was, good housekeeping and things. People get together and they burn comics. There were senatorial investigations. Bill Gaines, William Gaines, who actually published all of the EC comics, went down to testify before Congress, and things did not go the way that he had planned.
It had a lot to do with diet pills. He was very awake and manic in the morning and wanted to tell off these senators, but they didn't call until the afternoon when he was crashing, so he was not in good shape when they were trying to... he was telling them that he was proud of what he was doing, and then they said, do you think what you do is in good taste? And he says, well, for a horror story, the things I do are in good taste. And then they said, well, what about this? What could be in worse taste?
And he told them, didn't he?
He sure did.
He said that it could have actually shown, her severed windpipe and the neck and stuff. And he was actually...
And that's when comic books were killed, with that sentence.
He was very proud of himself because he had actually censored the comic by moving the image up.
Right, the original one did have the
jugular
showing.
Did have the severed neck and the windpipe and stuff, so...
See, but he saw this, Wertham, as creating juvenile delinquents because he was treating kids, and he'd find out they read comic books, and he made a causal connection. It's now called the Wertham fallacy because they also drank milk, which might have created juvenile delinquency, and kids just read comic books. In the 50s, it was a mass medium.
But... Now we've got EC Comics essentially get put out of business.
But wait, before we leave that, let's explain why he's complicated. Because what's interesting to me is, so he seemed to be the censorious creep. But then as I found out more about him, I found out things that were really amazing. Like I read an essay by Ralph Ellison called Dr. Nickel. And what it is that Wertham started the first black free psychiatric clinic, but he charged a nickel so everybody would be invested in their therapy. And he became Ellison's therapist and Richard Wright's therapist, and they found him a wonderful man. And he did a number of other things that were astounding. Like he was a witness for the defense in Brown versus Board of Education. He was the man who made comics a public cause when he was defending a nudist magazine from being pornographic. And he shows up and says, why are you so uptight? This is just the human body. If you want to see pornography, look at what I just bought down on the newsstand at the foot of the court building. And then he was dealing out these things. And that began a crusade. Now,
Do you have that famous picture? He illustrated his book, Seduction of the Innocent,
oh, yeah.
Dr. Frederick Bertham, with trying to prove that there was hidden porn.
In ordinary comic books, there are pictures within pictures for children who know how to look.
He is convinced.
You know, I got that book, I got Seduction of the Innocent out of the library when I was about, 13, 12 years old. I never returned it because I was a juvenile delinquent from all the comics I had read. And it also had, like in the back, a list of the forbidden of the comics that were the most pernicious. So I used to give those to my father as a want list because he was getting me two or three comics for a dime from an old backdate magazine store and had no idea. So I had to train him, don't bring me the love comics. Bring me the ones that look like they have monsters on them, okay? And that wasn't, he didn't know what he was doing, so it was fine. And for me, like, these things seemed to me in slightly later years as a secular Jewish response to Auschwitz in the post-war years of the dead coming back to life for revenge or for horror taking place in an everyday environment like the subway here, you know?
Well, of course, Bernie, there was that Bernie Krigstein story, which was one of the very few...
That was amazing. I wish I'd put that on my slide.
It was one of the very few stories in comics to actually tackle in its own way.
Yeah, the death camps were not part of popular culture like they are now, where there's the best Holocaust movie as one of the awards every year at the Oscars. At the time, it just wasn't part of the conversation. And here in this EC comic called Tales Designed to Carry an Impact, there was a story by a brilliant comic book artist, Bernie Krigstein, who invented new ways of breaking comics down as a painter who applied himself to comics just to earn some kind of money. He found how exciting comics could be, and I wish I'd brought it, but you were right, we would never have pictures of everything we could talk about. And it was such an amazing eye-opener for me. It planted the seed that eventually turned into that 13-year monster called Mouse, that comics could deal with this without being mere melodrama.
So Mad Magazine, basically, the little bit of history here, EC Comics goes almost out of business. They try publishing comics that aren't horror comics, like pirate comics and two-fisted psychoanalysis stories.
Oh, well, that's the main one. They did a comic book called, instead of like Tales Calculated to Drive You Mad or things like that, they did one called something like Seeking Peace of Mind Through Psychoanalysis. And the hero was a shrink. They were trying to placate this monster named Dr. Frederick Wortham. And the idea was, since they were collections of short pieces, the idea was each of the three stories in the issue would be an analysis session with a different patient. And then as one would get cured, presumably by issue three, because he had trouble with overeating, some other patient would take his spot. But the comic never lasted long enough for anybody to get cured. And the result was that basically all we were left with were comics based on television where the territory was ceded to the new mass media sensation and too many superheroes.
So then Harvey Kurtzman, the wonderful Harvey Kurtzman, creates the Mad comic for Bill Gaines. And
well, he turns it into a magazine, which was very smart. He had to convince Gaines to do that, which is, look, they're making all the comic books have this seal. Just change yourself from format to look like a Time magazine. And then it's a whole other world that you're operating in. And he actually did this amazing invention. When I look back at the early Mad magazines, they aren't necessarily built on comic stories. They're built on the photo layouts that made life a great magazine, mm-hmm. You know? And what he invested them in was teaching children who know how to look by knowing that there are pictures within pictures, that early Mad magazine was just so dense. Like, here was the border. When you look closely at the border, you find out that in one corner it says caricature, and the other one it says art, and it's just a picture of Venus on the half shell on a calendar. Literature is represented by a crossword puzzle. There are centaurs and nymphs wandering through the M. It was just packed with things that asked you to reread, which was why, although you were just saying earlier that, like, your teacher was telling you shouldn't read comics because they would make you stop reading, the essential truth was Mad was teaching you how to reread, because it was telling you that every time you went back, there was more to find. And that was an important lesson in terms of, A, finding out that there's more to just, like, gulping down a story and moving on, you know, that going back in allows you to really experience something. And ultimately, it was this word that they used to describe what they were doing, those chicken fat. Like here, something that inspired Mao's as much as any other Tom and Jerry version of the Animal Kingdom was Mickey Roden telling you that Mickey Mouse was a rodent. He had stubble. There were rat traps attached to his fingers. And in fact, here's Horace Horsecollar being dragged off by the Disney police because he's not wearing the regulation white gloves. Here's an animal having a human for a pet. And the pictures went unpacked very slowly, you know? And it really encouraged looking. Just to finish off on Mad, I brought that one picture that seemed like the essence of what Mad was to me, which was the antidote to the 1950s. Like Norman Rockwell's America, the only way people really got through it, as we've learned from several seasons of Mad Men, is by being 12 sheets to the wind, you know? So here's like, what makes a glass of beer taste so good? A visit to Grandpa's house with, I don't know, beer in the fishbowl, the baby being fed some beer.
You've got the parrot drinking beer as well.
A dog foaming at the mouth from the suds. So in something that was uncannily like Norman Rockwell, but subverting it, it created the antidote to the 50s, which was a certain kind of ironic distance from what you were looking at, which served several generations really well, you know? I just realized that without Kurtzman, we would not have had a protest against the Vietnam War, because it taught you to question authority, the monolithic authority of images. And that was great until irony was turned into air quotes, you know, that kind of cynicism only, you know, that kind of nothing affects me.
So what's the difference between Mad magazine teaching you to question everything and cynicism?
Well, the thing about Mad was it always tried to tell you something true. You know, that when he did this thing, this Mickey Roden thing, he was telling you that the Disney universe isn't so squeaky clean. You know, this idea of Horace Horsecollar being dragged off by the police for not being normative was an important lesson to learn. In later pages of the story that I didn't bring, he questions everything, including the drawing style that they're in. Like, they look down as they're brought into the woods, it gets much more sinister, and then Donald Duck says, look, it's not signed by Walt Disney anymore, it's by Billy Elder. And then by the last panel, Donald Duck is in a cage squawking with real ducks, you know? And you're made to understand the sign system of comics, even. So it's always like pushing you to understand something more, not less. Cynicism just is a way of shutting down. It's not a way of examining what's worthy and what isn't. And like, I knew this was true when I figured out that Mayor Giuliani had a complete set of Mad magazines. So he had learned the ironic lessons of not believing in anything, but being a power-hungry Mussolini wannabe and trying to put it over. That's very different than learning the lessons of we have to be real, we have to actually understand what we're living through. And Mad, I think, offered that in its earlier incarnations. And as a result, we ended up in a world where we're all in the spin room being spun rather than being taken back to like really see what's being done to us.
So, I mean, one of the reasons why I love the fact we've talked so much about MAD is one can see the MAD DNA in your work in a number of different directions. Some of it less obviously, like Mouse, some of it more obviously, like Garbage Pail Kids.
Well, absolutely.
Where you got into
that was
the
like
same
wanting
kind
to corrupt a generation the way I had been corrupted. Like, I thought it was important to pass the lessons on when I worked for a bubblegum company. So I was able to do first Wacky Packages and art direct.
There's a Wacky Packages fan out there.
You know, I can date my age and people's ages by knowing which one they respond to stronger, and then Garbage Pail Kids, which was easier for another generation. And now I just get blank looks because it's all back in the 80s, you know. But, you know, when you're... Can we stay on this subject or do you
want
to...
Yeah, let's stay.
There's something that was really interesting because you said something about not so obvious in Mouse. The thing I learned from Harvey Kurtzman, the genius behind MAD, was about some formal relationship to what a comic story is. Mm-hmm. Which is to say, you know, comics didn't have a D.W. Griffith who invented long shots, close-ups, cross-cutting, all of the vocabulary of cinema in 1912 and on, with Intolerance and other movies. Comics language developed more incrementally, and Kurtzman had the clearest kind of syntax for telling comic stories. Like, there's a story I started talking to you about and saying, I don't think it'll come up, but now I think it's worth bringing up if we're going to talk about Mouse, which is, what is a page and how does one structure it? Like, see, as well as doing the MAD, he also did a comic called Two-Fisted Tales at the height of the Korean War. War stories that weren't like Sergeant Rock or the Marvel versions of these things that were all just like John Wayne He-Man tossing grenades into a pile of weird yellow-skinned creatures. He did a story in this called Corpse on the Imogen that he drew as well as broke down. It's taking place during the Korean War. There's talking
and the,
about
and the Korean War was going on while the comic
while this
was
comic
coming
book
out.
Was done. Yeah, he also had stories that took place in the Civil War and World War I and II. But this one, Korean War story, looking at a corpse floating down the Imogen River and wondering how it died. So this page is three tiers, two of which are a large panel. Then three horizontal panels with a horizontal figure going by, because horizontal means inert, right? Like lying down or dead. Then we go to a person watching it and speculating on how that person did, a GI who's wondering how he might have died. All of these are built on the vertical of somebody sitting somewhere. And then there's this amazing thing. He's beginning to eat his K rations while he's speculating about this. And there's a face inside the bushes, a yellow face. Now, in any other war comic, this is the exact moment that a battle happens, hand-to-hand combat. He's saying, maybe that corpse died in hand-to-hand combat, but that never happens. And then what he does is an astonishing thing. He shifts over, again, in three-tiered panels, everyone either two panels wide or three panels wide, so it's kind of even rhythms. You get to see over the shoulder of the Korean soldier who's hungry and is not attacking for ideological reasons, but from hunger. And it lets you identify with this as a human, which is the opposite of the way war comic jingoism worked. Then, as he leaps at him to get the food, it becomes a swirl of activity, right? Like they're circling around each other. There are a lot of diagonals. It becomes frantic and active as they're fighting each other. Here, each row of text, now you know this because you've written many comics that have a lot of text in them. What he's done is allowed there to be a lot of text, but he's always making sure that it's three lines of text so that the box doesn't have to change size, so the rhythm remains the same. So the verbal rhythms are part of making that page happen. In the center there are these diagonals, and then we go to a page where they're both in the river, and he begins to... they're struggling, he's dunking him down to the river. Verticals again, with these ripples coming up out of his arms as he submerges the Korean and manages to run away, having barely survived this hand-to-hand combat. And then the body moves through its diagonals and circles down and floats down the Imogen River from this moment of hand-to-hand combat. It's a very short story, six pages is usually just enough time for somebody to clear their throat in contempo graphic novels, as they call them, you know? And I think it's actually a very poetically charged story, a beautifully drawn thing, very brought down to its graphic design. And it actually taught me this kind of comic storytelling, which was as much present in Mad Comics as in the War Comics, had these very definitive rhythms. Each page is a paragraph. And it wasn't just a run-on sentence of panels until the story got told. And I think that's what I learned most when working on Mouse, was how to structure pages from Harvey and from Will Eisner as well. You know, people thought about the page.
I was fascinated when I first started writing comics, because I thought the unit was the panel, and right. I rapidly learned that no, the unit of communication here is the page, and you have to think pages. And I would drive my editors mad by wanting to know which pages were going to be facing adverts, because mm-hmm. I was writing for DC Comics and there were ads, which I wanted to know because I always wanted to know when somebody was turning a page, because what I was going to do on a left-hand page and what I was going to do on a right-hand page were very different. You cannot surprise somebody on a right-hand page.
That's right, because when you turn the page, it's like lifting a curtain on a stage.
You can subliminally see whatever's on the right-hand page. You can glance at it. But I can surprise you on a left-hand page. You can turn over that page and see something that you weren't expecting.
Well, guiding your eye through a page, like I also learned by negative example from an old Batman story, in which when somebody was working too fast, they'd have to use these arrows to move you around. Because here, if you read straight across, you'd fall down an elevator shaft. And so to protect you, it's like, no, go over here. Oh, okay, now you're safe, you know? And I found these things very inspiring, like this page that you could read any of many ways, and it finally ends in the middle of the page, where it says, dead end, start again, was part of... And I learned from that, and Harvey, and Will Eisner, who we were talking about before we got out here, like this page of Mouse, it's a very important page. It's where Vladek is really entering into telling me the part of the story that I dreaded to have to draw, which was the oxymoron of life in a death camp. So we stall. There's like several anecdotes that come before, and I'm trying to get my father to go back and say, but what happened when you and Anja were separated? And then we stall yet again with Vladek saying, we were never separated, we just weren't together, you know, like some distinction. She was taken to the women's camp, I was taken to the men's camp. Now what happens here is you're made to read down not by arrows, but by balloons that pull you down, and the balloons overlap, and the scenes stay relatively static, so it's easy for you to follow this down before going across a large gutter when Vladek finally starts talking about his entry into the death camp. And at that point, you have to read down again, and that becomes a descent into the beast's maw. Now, it's not what I expect somebody to be sub-vocalizing while reading the story, but it's the way to really use all of the elements of comics to make that story happen, and that's something that I learned from Harvey.
One of the things that fascinated me about watching, going to the museum exhibit recently, the career retrospective of Art Spiegelman, was seeing the incredible amount of work that went into Mouse, and realizing that the glorious simplicity of every Mouse page, it was allowed to be simple because it was underneath it was an iceberg of drawings, of sketches, of plans for that page.
Well, the thing I would do is I do like about 40 tries for each box and kind of bring them into focus. And then I'd have to go back about 12 steps from the one I thought was the finished one because it would get too illustration-y. Because what I needed was something that fell between handwriting and a typeface. It had to have the clarity of the latter while having the informality of the former. And it's also why those drawings, as you saw at that exhibit, were so small. Like, they're drawn the same size that they're published because that created the intimacy of it feeling like a manuscript rather than, you know, most comic book pages.
They're huge.
And then that minimizes the errors, and I needed the errors to be actual size. So that was part of making these pages that way, you know. I didn't learn that right away. Like you had asked me at some point, and so it's in here, and it might be appropriate now. When Mao started, I was doing it more like my underground comics betters, where I was a junior partner in that underground comics moment. You know.
I remember reading this for the first time. I was about 15 years old, and it was reprinted in a book called Comics Book, I think, with a comics with an X, published by, of all people, Marvel Comics.
I know, I just let them have it as a reprint because otherwise they'd own the rights and could make the movie.
So, but I remember reading this three-page mouse as a 15-year-old and finding it hugely, strangely troubling. And I had my own set of huge Holocaust issues that had begun when I was 9 or 10 years old and asked to do a family tree for school and got to phone up my aunt and put together this family tree and realized that one branch had survived, you know, the branch that came to England, and then there was a little sort of twig that went off to America.
I took something from, I never had much use for my relatives, but I found this guy when I was working on that book Metamouse about Mouse, fine fellow, cousins, Hi Spiegelman, who'd become the family genealogist, you know, and he had made exactly that family tree, and it got to me the same way that when you were nine, it was like, oh, holy God, because it was exactly that. It was like the family in 1938 and the family in 1946, and it was the same thing, but with blank boxes everywhere. Nobody was left in 1946, just one little branch that included him and me, because cousins were really the same as brothers and sisters after the war. The only family you could find were through several steps of remove. But I reproduced that diagram in MetaMouse over two spreads, and it still chokes me up in a way that the book doesn't, because I've had to be so clinical about making Mouse. Mm. Well.
So where did that initial idea come from? This three-pager, just the idea of, okay, you're going to do a story, and this is a bedtime story.
Right, it's framed as a kid hearing it from his dad. Well, there's an underground comic being put together. I don't have the cover of it with this set of slides, but it was called Funny Aminals. And in the underground comics moment, editing consisted of how many pages do you want, and just hand them in by approximately this month. And I was really interested in doing something because Crumb was doing the cover, and Crumb was the most accomplished, most important cartoonist of that generation. I admire him enormously. He had been scarred by the same mad cover I had been scarred by, told us that comics didn't have to have punchlines, plunge into the depths of despair, see if anything's on, why bother? And when he wasn't doing that, he was breaking every taboo that the comic code had put into place. And he was doing the cover of this book, you know? And so the only requirement was to do something with anthropomorphic characters. And at first I was trying to do some kind of EC horror comic with cats and mice, and just have the mouse be caught in a mousetrap at the end or something, as it was just a horror comic. And it seemed like just an exercise in style, rather trivial. And what Crumb did in that book was these two little foxes are chasing after this enormous big-legged woman who's a chicken, and they lure her up to the apartment so they can eat her, not in the sexual sense, but in the what foxes do to chicken sense. And meanwhile, I had like been assigned an anthropomorphic story, didn't know what on earth to do, but a person who was very important to me, Ken Jacobs, filmmaker, I was sitting in on his classes, and he was showing old Mickey Mouse cartoons, and he was showing old racist cartoons with those big Al Jolson-lipped creatures, and he was saying, well, what's the difference between Steamboat Willie's Mickey Mouse and these race caricatures? They're the same, they're all subhumans. And then that sort of gave me this moment where I said, I'm going to do a comic about blacks in America, and it'll have like big-lipped mice, and it'll have Ku Klux cats. And I was really excited for about 24 hours before I realized I know nothing about the black experience in America. And all I can come across as is one more racist or a well-meaning liberal idiot, you know? So there's no place to go with that. But then Kafka's Josephine the Singer came to mind, which was a metaphor of the Jews as mice, and allowed what became that three-page story to happen.
Hmm. My cousin Helen, who is 96 and was professor of the Holocaust at Miami University and was a Holocaust survivor herself, hates mouse. Mm-hmm. And I got to listen to her tell me why she hated it for 5 minutes of going, you know, it's ridiculous, it portrays the Jews as mice and so on and so forth, and it's a cartoon. And she got to the end of that, and then she started telling me something else. And 2 minutes into that, she started telling me how the Nazis called us rodents, and they said we were subhuman, and she completely failed to see that the two things lined up.
Well,
absolutely.
I mean, I've certainly gotten a lot of heat from Poles about drawing them as pigs. The Jews are so long-suffering and so used to being put down that I've hardly ever heard that particular response, you know? But also, because of the way the book is structured, these are self-destructing metaphors. They're metaphors that are meant to fall apart, you know?
Yep.
Like, there's a place where, in one little scene, there's a Jewish guy who's with a German woman, and they have a kid, and the kid is like a mouse with cat stripes on it, you know? It's not meant to be taken as literal that they're different species. Or when my father's wandering around Poland, he's wearing a Woolworth pig mask that has strings hanging off the back. Some of the Poles behave really well, some behave badly, some of the Jews behave well, some behave badly. So that a number of places in the book, that particular metaphor, it just is you're asked to let it dissolve. And it just allows actually something really important, which is the little orphan Annie's eyeball effect to take place. Because I always found Little Orphan Annie a lot more emotionally evocative than, say, Little Abner, with a much more exaggerated drawing style, because you were asked to project the expression and ultimately the face through these blank pieces of paper that were inside those oval eyeballs, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so it allows somebody to become much more specific by you doing the work of finding that specific person. And I figured if I was off on a search for verisimilitude, I'd collapse in 5 seconds. I don't know what these Polish people looked like. I don't know what Vladek's friend looked like. There's no photo reference to go to. And by just having a mouse mask, it was just you project the face, I will just give you the body gesture as if it was some kind of Japanese no theater or something, you know?
How do you feel about, just before we went on, I got a email from a friend saying, you're with Art Spiegelman. I just had to write a 7-page essay on a couple of panels of mouse. How do you feel about mouse being taught?
I used to really be upset about it because I learned to hate George Eliot. I think every kid in the New York State school system was issued what I guess were remaindered copies of Silas Marner. It's not a great book for 12-year-olds.
For me, it was poor Thomas Hardy, who I know if I'd come to him as an adult, I would have loved Thomas Hardy.
I came to him as an adult. He's amazing. Oh, the obscure. Wow.
14, wrong age to be assigned your Thomas Hardy.
Well, I was really terrified that that's what would happen here. And I don't know, maybe kids are more docile or they trust their teachers more or something. But Mouse never got that kind of... I have heard the shit, we had to write a paper about it, you know, but... beyond that, there was a kind of immersion in a book that felt honest to them. And that, I suppose, makes me more reconciled to the fact that it was like being given a MacArthur Genius Grant without having to ask for one or be granted one, because Mouse stays in print, probably because it's taught from middle school up through post-grad. And most books, as unlike yours, but most books have the shelf life of yogurt or something, you know? So I'm grateful that it's there. Although, obviously, I'm not always happy to have a 500 pound mouse like chasing me everywhere. It's something I have to both be grateful for and chafe at.
Let's talk about some of the other stuff that you've done then. Because you have done an incredible amount. And one of the things, of course, that you've done, I don't know if you have any of the pictures on your thing, but one of the things that you did was during the 90s, you seemed to shock America very regularly on the New Yorker covers.
Yeah, I didn't bring
and
that.
And they'd get all grumpy. And I used to love that. There'd be an Art Spiegelman.
You know, this was amazing. Before the internet, it was like there were only a few things that could gather everybody together and focus. And it seemed the New Yorker covers were absolutely one of those things. Now, only having grown exponentially greater, as Francoise has allowed those early shocking covers to become integrated into the DNA of what the New Yorker still does. You know, like that Obama fist bump cover that had everybody talking a few years ago. Grew out of that first moment where I'd been invited by a crazy person named Tina Brown, who's the editor and had no special respect for the New Yorker's traditions. And she just wanted covers that would liven everything up, I guess, and invited me into the magazine. And I was looking to see what the covers were. And there were great old covers by Charles Adams and beyond, but the recent covers were just like what William Shawn wanted to have as a moment of respite on the newsstands, like a cat on a windowsill. Nicely done in good, studious postmodern, late modern pastiches, really, of post-impressionism and whatever. But they were really very bucolic. As Francoise pointed out to me at some point, the whole issue of the New Yorker that was devoted to Hiroshima had a Connecticut country scene on the cover. So I saw that a lot of the covers were devoted to holidays and things like that, or it's spring, things like that. And about the time I was invited in, it was Valentine's Day that was coming up, and I was thinking about the Crown Heights riots that brought the West Indian community, the African-American community on one side, and the Hasidic Jews in Crown Heights. Then it wasn't hipsters then, now it's changed. To blows, and it was racial hatred on both sides that led to bloodshed. And basically, I was just doodling, not knowing what I wanted to make, and I was drawing that Eustace Tilly guy with the monocle, and said, I wonder what he'd look like if he was a Jew. So I just put a Hasidic hat and beard on him, and then before I knew it, he was kissing this West Indian African American woman. And that was my Valentine's cover, you know? Why don't they just kiss and make up? Man, did that get people upset. That was the one that really did it.
I'd freshly come over from England at that point, and I actually got to do a, boy, those Americans are very strange moment, as the country briefly seemed about to descend into turmoil, civil war.
You know, that cover would have never made a dent if it was an underground comics cover, but on the New Yorker, where everything was very genteel, not Gentile, but genteel, they barely ever even had close-up covers. They were never in your face. It was mostly those bucolic distance scenes, except for that monocled Eustace Tilly. And when this thing happened, we were in Florida, Francoise and I, with the kids, coming back from an opening of a show of art that I had there, that actually Eisner had a hand in setting up. And we were besieged at the airport by 1,000 journalists, like all over the place, and it looked like I was trying to get to Cuba. We had our luggage, our kids, get out of town fast because they were going to tar and feather me. And when I got back, the next day, the op-ed page of the New York Times was like scorching this thing. This woman who was teaching creative writing at Queens College, but was so apoplectic she couldn't put together a decent sentence, was complaining about everything about that cover, including, in describing it, the Jews' lascivious lips. And the same day, there was a piece in the Washington Post in which a rabbi was writing about it and talking about the Jews' prim lips. And, you know, I'm just not a great draftsman, I confess it. And I certainly can't draw them lascivious and prim at the same time. So I realized that the problem was that the Jew had lips at all.
And that he was kissing with them.
And you know, like I'd been told, like this cover could cause problems. And I think the real reason was because there's a lot of talk about how a lot of the Hasidic Jews were like hiring black hookers underneath the Williamsburg Bridge. That never made print, but that was what I didn't know about that, but I think that was the real problem. But nevertheless, I was getting attacked by the Jewish community, and I figured as a maker of iconoclastic images, I was in trouble with the Hasidic community where there's a commandment against graven images. And I was sternly told that, you know, a Hasidic Jewish man is not even allowed to touch his wife in public. And I could have, you know, copped a plea. I could have just said, like, well, who said it's in public? It's just a red background. And she's Sephardic, you know? There's no issue here. And I didn't bother with that, but I did get attacked on every front, so that on the same day I was on one of those attack radio shows, and this black minister from Crown Heights was saying, if you had any guts, you'd have shown a black man kissing a Jewish lady. And I explained that I thought he might be a good minister. I've never attended his congregation, but he was a really terrible art director because nobody would recognize a woman with a handkerchief on her head as a Jew as quickly as they would one of these guys in full Jewish drag. And at the same moment, he'd be on the radio complaining that one more time the black man was shown as a sexual aggressor against white women, and we'd be in the same conversation because this was ultimately a Rorschach test, this cover. And I've got to finish. You set off that tape.
No,
the best letter we got was a young girl writing a letter thinking it was really sweet that on Abraham Lincoln's birthday we had a cover of Lincoln kissing a slave. So, go figure. I don't know. But to me, it was just like doing Mad Magazine for adults, you know? I didn't bring any of the New Yorker covers.
I know, which is why it's kind of fun to talk about them, because you can't now go into your computer. You have to stay here and stuff.
I'll be with you. Okay. I can show you another mouse page. Now, let me show you one that we did talk about before, which was in that underground comics moment. I got to do things that were really exploring the nature of comics, like this thing that you said you had seen at a crucial moment. Which was after I thought I was all washed up, which happens to me every 2 weeks, I think. And here, while really lost and not knowing what kind of comics I could make next, I was just playing with cutout panels from the newspaper dailies. And eventually started collaging.
Do you often play with cutout panels from newspaper dailies when you feel lost?
Well, in this period, yes. Now I just get lost in the internet and I don't come up for days. But at that time, I'd be cutting things apart and moving things around. Okay. And eventually, I got to the point where I was extending panels. So here was, this is the most boringly drawn comic strip I saw, which was Rex Morgan, M.D. And then I realized that with this panel that I kind of graffitied around it, I then took a Rex Morgan from days later that fit almost as well into the same graffiti. And then began to just figure out what could happen with all these things and created something that was called the malpractice suite because it was so musical, finally, in which the language becomes balloons of organized stutter. And it allowed me to find all these odd things, you know, like here in the panel that I was collaging in, there's a sleeve, you know, and just becomes this Asian gentleman, you know. And I found that that was a very revivifying moment for me as a cartoonist that I then found out became very important to a group of cartoonists in France much later. They started something. Did you ever hear of Ubepo?
No, tell me.
Okay. There was something called Ulipo in France, which was Ouvre Littéraire de Possibilité or something. It was about writing a novel without the letter E in it.
Oh, yes.
Which became translated.
Which they translated it and did it without the letter A.
Yeah, in a novel called A Void. So that kind of building stuff around limitations. in order to open up other possibilities, was adopted by a bunch of comics artists in France who set up impossible limitations, like make a narrative out of other people's drawings that you shuffle panels around and repeat. And I was very proud to read that I was called a premature plagiarist.
You stole the idea from them before they thought of it.
Before they had it, damn it, yeah. So, you know, I didn't bring a lot of my work. I thought we'd be talking about you.
I did warn you. I said the conversation will go wherever it will go. Let me ask one question, which is, we've actually gone from your childhood into your Pulitzer Award-winning self now, via Mad Magazine and Batman and things like that. To what extent do you think that you've wound up recapitulating and fulfilling childhood desires? Were you somebody? At what point did you know that you wanted to do comics, for example?
Oh, as soon as I understood they were made by people rather than like being like rocks and trees, which was looking at those Mads closely, you'd see that they were drawn by different people. You know, that a personality was finding expression, and that seemed really exciting to me. And I suppose that just never stopped. Usually, you get scolded out of it. You know, like you can't draw. There's enough to stop. It hasn't stopped me. You know, and I guess I know that, like, on some level, I'm responsible for something I no longer am convinced I think is a good idea, which is the graphic novel. because, you know, I got told I was the, I was introduced to one of these events and it was explained that I was the father of the graphic novel, and I came out and demanded a blood test. because for me, comics are an art of compression. Mm-hmm. And it was like when I was showing you that corpse on the Imogen story, 6 pages to do something that was that evocative. Or the one that we didn't have to show, which was that Master Race story by Bernard Krigstein about the Holocaust in 6 pages, was what comics do so well. They're an abbreviated form of writing, an abbreviated form of drawing, closer, as I think James Sturm, who has his comic school up in Vermont, put it, comics aren't about drawing and writing, they're about graphic design and poetry.
I love that quote. I wish really somebody had told me that when I was.
It's an important clue.
Kid.
It's not about illustration exactly, you know. Like, so the visual compression is part of its power, and not everything should be a 300-page story. If I could draw better, Mouse would have been 2,000 pages. It's a compressed 300 pages, and it took 13 years to compress. And a lot of what I'm seeing now just feels like people who haven't had a chance to figure out how to make a good comics page are making 300-page comic books. And I'm not sure that that's the best or only possible place to go. So I'm interested in what's happening now because things have exploded. But I'm not sure what it all means, because there's too much for anybody to keep track of. You know, we keep track of the genres that we followed before, perhaps, or the artists that we've learned to understand. But now, even the publishers I talk to have no idea what's going on in the larger scene that would be called the subset of culture called comics. And it's impossible to get a grasp on it, because it's as vast as what we're calling movies. You know, you can't see them all. So it's got to like shake itself out and find out where it's going, but it's impossible to know what's up, because with the arrival of web comics, with the arrival of home printers, there's things appearing every day, some of which will become significant clearly in a decade or so, but it's hard to understand it the way I used to know who inked the Flash in a given issue, even though I hated those comic books, the superhero comics. They were for the kids who used to try to beat me up. And I knew all that because comics was such a small universe that you could know every corner of it,
you didn't even have to like them, and you could tell the difference between Dick Giordano in King and somebody else in King or whatever. Yeah. But so we're now in a world in which, I mean, when you started hitting the headlines, I was a young journalist writing the stories, and the headlines, no matter what I wrote as my headline, somebody back on the newspaper would decide the headline was Wham! Smash! Pow! Comics have grown up. Or occasionally, Bang! Kapow! Comics, they aren't just for kids anymore.
Well, here's a picture of what adult comic book readers were perceived as, which is cretins, basically. But there was a sea change around 1985, according to the scientific chart. And everything, the world just changed. So that now people who read and draw comic books can get dates.
So I've been told. So of course, having you know, got your Pulitzer for Mouse and having become the blood test demanding father of the graphic novel, you then promptly did a comic for your wife's line for kids.
Yeah, well, Francoise was seeing those same headlines and looking around and finding out that there weren't comics for kids anymore. Like, those were dying while this new book-length comic book was being born. And so first we did something called Little Lit, which were comics for kids of all ages, and an annual anthology done by a lot of A-game children's book illustrators like Maurice Sendak, A-list writers like you, working with A-list cartoonists like Gayan Wilson, doing these annuals, because we were inspired by something that didn't exist in America, which were those Christmas annuals that would come out in bookstores of comics.
Yep.
We told that that doesn't work in America, and they were right. But we did do three annual volumes of this over 4 years. And the big fallacy in it, to an extent, was we're doing this as comics for kids of all ages. And the problem with that is there's no such thing as a kid of all ages except an adult. Each kid is very specifically 4, 5, 7, 9, 11, and those are very different brains. And trying to do it all in one book wasn't quite the thing, even though it has wonderful stories in it, and it is for kids of all ages, as long as you're picking through it. Some will be more immediately appealing than others. And what Francoise really wanted to do was, having seen that although our daughter learned to read because you couldn't stop her, Dash was having some issues with it, but she would read French comics to him, I'd be reading American comics, and lo and behold, comics were indeed that gateway drug to literacy. And she wanted to use comics more effectively to teach kids how to read, and did an attack on a full-scale assault on the world's worst books, the ones that are supposed to make you love them, the early readers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were done by people who couldn't have cared less about what they were doing. They feel inert. Like, I'll retell Cinderella with the word list, and I'll get my high school age daughter to draw Cinderella for it. And then it would show Cinderella looking beautiful and say Cinderella was beautiful. And you didn't have to read those words because you saw Cinderella looking beautiful, so it just would tell you, don't bother to learn to read, kids. Your eyes will tell you everything you need to know. But comics, because you really do want to decode the squiggle and find out why Donald Duck is looking angry, encourage this thing, and really were an incredibly useful way to learn to read. And she's done these toon books that are leveled readers, now expanded into being for kids slightly older that could actually take in full stories. And in these books, figured out that, in the comics ones, that you learn to read the same way you learn to talk. Like, these words that we're using here are all just a bunch of arbitrary symbols, but when your mother's leaning over and says, does baby want some milk? And then depending on the family, either hands you a breast or a bottle. You begin to associate it with something good like your mother's smile, and you learn that the sound milk means something useful and nourishing. And it's a combination of acting out, of gesture, of connection, and that gesturing is easier in a multiple page of panels than in one image very often. And she's been using that to do these stories. And now that she's expanded, we've co-mixed the words and pictures together, and you've finally done something for us that completely scrambles that relationship up by taking the words and pictures and giving them own their each separate solos in a book, so that where we had started when we came out, the slide that happened to be on was a picture from Hansel and Gretel, which we have here someplace, which we have here exactly, drawn by an artist we both admire named Lorenzo Matodi, who had done a suite of drawings doing Hansel and Gretel as if they were Clifford Still paintings.
They're really wonderful, and it's one of the very few times I was at your apartment about a year ago and was shown these illustrations, was shown these amazing sort of paintings. And at first glance, they look like just sort of wild splashes of ink. And then in that one, you see the children, and you realize they're lost in the forest.
And it caught something genuine and sinister about a fairy tale, not the sugar plum fairy version.
Well, Francoise said, would I like to write my own Hansel and Gretel? And it was one of those glorious moments, because there are very few things that I could actually say, yes, I have been waiting all my life for somebody to say, will you write Hansel and Gretel? But that one actually was. It was like, yes, I really want
sorry,
to.
I didn't mean to go
and,
away.
And so I did. I wrote...
No, sorry.
I wrote a... and it's completely straight. It's a very... tried not to do anything fancy with it. I just tried to make it as real as I possibly could.
What was great was you didn't do, even though I just heard you called the, what was it, the king of postmodernism or something?
It's one of those things which is now almost vaguely embarrassing, because I think it was circa 1992. I was on the Dictionary of Literary Biography list of the top 10 postmodern writers. And in a postmodern way, they put 11 people on there. But the problem is that I think about at least 6 or 7 of those people, some of whom were my friends, have now died. So there's now only about 3 of us left who were in the original 11 of the top 10 living postmodern writers.
Because basically what's happened to a lot of fairy tales is they get turned into Hansel and Gretel Vampire Hunter. And it doesn't allow the kid to experience Hansel and Gretel. You're immediately put into the wisecracked version.
It's the equivalent of what both of us have done in some ways, which is you read the equivalent of the Mad Magazine parody before you encounter the thing itself.
And you have to data sift for the original.
I mean, that was how I discovered Superman. I discovered Superman in a Jules Feiffer cartoon, which was a parody of Superman, which you astonished me when we were talking earlier. You actually
all
actually
of a sudden
had
it was just appearing. Yeah, what are you doing?
It's this comic. It's got Superman. He has his arms like that, akimbo.
Talk slower.
Technically. and he is saying, I used to be Superman. Everywhere you looked, I was rescuing people. I was flying around and rescuing people. I was about 5 years old, and the book was called The Explainers. And I had no idea what I was reading other than he is Superman. And he says, and one day I pulled this chick out of the river. And as far as I was concerned, this was a baby chicken. And he pulls her out of the river. And as she starts asking him why he feels this compulsive need to rescue people, and what's his relationship like with his mother, and he explains to her that she shouldn't judge him like she judges Earth people, and eventually he gets her to admit that while he may not be super, he is a little better than average, and he gets a job in the city, and they're doing just fine. And that was my first encounter with Superman, so every other encounter I've ever had with Superman is in the shadow of that.
Could I show you the other Pfeiffer thing that you didn't know? This is great. I was looking in Playboy magazine. It was before the internet. And there's this two-page strip that's this perfect minimalist comic strip. Oh God, it's wonderful, oh God, it's wonderful. Dear God, dear, dear God, 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 God. Oh God, God, God. Joyce? Joyce, you all right? Wonderful. Me too. Wonderful. Just wonderful. Joyce? Yes, darling. Joyce, I love you. Joyce? Are you crying, Joyce? Yes, I'm crying. Oh, Bernard, why did you have to spoil it? It's amazing, you know? Because Jules, even when he was drawing, would like keep these things very minimalist. But here, this is as minimalist as the drawing can get. It's just an abstract version of the stem of a speech balloon that represents Joyce and Bernard. And you get to see how drawing and writing are extensions of each other, because I wasn't deciding to read this softer than this. You're told to read it softer because it's smaller. And then Jules said that one of his big inspirations as a cartoonist was Jack Benny. Mm-hmm. That everything's about timing. The radio stuff would have just the right pause. And he said when he was doing these three panels, he really only eventually got to three by having just had it be one, then two, and then it had to be three. That was the right amount of space before Joyce. and then over even here, where God, 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 you know, he's thrusting into her, you know? Like, it's like these writings are coming in.
That's what's going on?
Absolutely, man. Just look at that black box. It's hot. Many different kinds of black. These blacks are different than the Lorenzo Mattotti blacks of Hansel and Gretel. Actually, you know, since we're probably going to stop soon, why don't I ask if you wouldn't mind to read a little bit of what you did to Hansel and Gretel? Because I was a skeptic when I first heard this was going to happen. Because I thought you'd either find some very newfangled way to do it, or would just, like, phone it in.
Your confidence in me is gratifying.
I just didn't know. My mind was blown that you could find a way to do Hansel and Gretel that was absolutely straight, would feel like yours, and get to the heart of something about the story that wouldn't otherwise be obvious.
Okay, I'll read. I mean, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'll read... Read a little bit at the beginning, and then we'll go over and do questions and answers. You lot can do the questions. We'll do the answers. Okay. This is kind of fun. I like the idea of reading 700 adults. A little bit of Hansel and Gretel. This all happened a long time ago, in your grandmother's time, or in her grandfather's, a long time ago. Back then, we all lived on the edge of the great forest. There was a woodcutter. He cut down trees. He chopped the branches off the trees, and he cut the trunks and the branches into logs for firewood, which he would haul on a handcart to the nearest path into the town. It was hungry work, cutting trees. The woodcutter took a pretty young wife who helped him as best she could. She cooked for him. And she gave him every comfort, so it was no surprise to them that shortly after they were married, her belly began to swell. And in the winter, when the snows were high, she gave birth to a girl. The child was called Margaret, which they shortened to Greta, and then to Gretel. 2 years later, the woodcutter's wife gave birth to a boy, and they called him Hans, which, because they could make it no shorter, they made longer and changed to Hansel. Hansel and Gretel did not go to school, for the schools were far from the forest where they lived, and schools cost money which the woodcutter did not have enough of, for you do not make much money from hewing wood and hauling logs. Even so, their father taught them the way of the woods, and their mother taught them how to cook and to clean and to sew. And if their mother was sometimes bitter and sharp-tongued, and if their father was sometimes sullen, and eager to be away from their little home, why, Gretel and Hansel thought nothing of it, as long as they could play in the forest and climb trees and ford rivers, as long as there were freshly baked bread and eggs and cooked cabbage on their table. When the wood sold well, their father would buy meat for the family at the market, a fat-tailed sheep or a goat, which he'd bring back trotting behind his hand-drawn cart, or even a hunk of raw beef dripping with blood, black with flies or yellow with wasps, and the family would feast that evening. There were rabbits in the forest. There were ducks in the woodcutter's pond. There were chickens scratching in the dirt behind the woodcutter's tiny house. There was always food. That was in the good days, before the war, before the famine. War came, and the soldiers came with it, hungry, angry, bored, scared men, who, as they passed through, stole the cabbages and the chickens and the ducks. The woodcutter's family was never certain who was fighting whom, nor why they were fighting, nor what they were fighting about. But beyond the forest, fields of crops were burned, and barley fields became battlefields, and the farmers were killed or made into soldiers in their turn and marched away. And soon enough, the miller had no grain to mill into flour, the butcher had no animals to kill and hang in his window, and they said you could name your own price for a fat rabbit. Soon enough, the root vegetables rotted in the fields, all the turnips and carrots and potatoes, for there were fewer and fewer people to dig them up. And it rained, so the only things to eat there fell in those fields were the slugs. The woodcutter's cottage was far from the battles, but the woodcutter and his wife and Gretel and Hansel all felt the war's effect. They ate soup made from old cabbage leaves, into which the children would dip their stale bread, now hard as a stone, and the family went to bed hungry and woke up hungrier. The children slept on straw pallets. Their parents slept in an ancient bed that had once belonged to the woodcutter's grandmother. Hansel woke in the night, a sharp, empty pain in his stomach, but he did not say anything, for he knew there was little enough to eat. He kept his eyes closed and tried to return to sleep. When he slept, he was not hungry. He could hear his parents talking in the darkness. "There are four of us," his mother was saying, "four mouths to feed. If we keep going like this, we'll all die. Without the extra mouths, you and I will have a chance." "We cannot," replied the woodcutter in a whisper. "It would be a monstrous thing to do to kill our children, and I will have no part in it." "Lose them, not kill them," said the woodcutter's wife. "Nobody said anything about killing anybody. We'll take them deep into the forest and lose them. They will be fine. Perhaps a kind person will take them in and feed them. And we can always have more children," she added practically. "A bear might eat them," said the woodcutter dejectedly. "We cannot do this thing." "If you do not eat," said his wife, "then you will not be able to swing an axe. And if you cannot cut down a tree or haul the wood into the town, then we all starve and die. Two dead are better than four dead. That is mathematics, and it is logic." "I care for neither your mathematics nor your logic," grumbled the woodcutter, "but I can argue no more." And Hansel heard only silence from his parents' bed. So, the plan right now, if we can have some house lights up, we're going to do the thing where we actually have microphones, one here and one there, and if you have a question, come down and come to the microphone. And we're going to do that because we couldn't figure out a way to get a mic up to any of you lot up there, but we figured that you could always run down if you wanted. There will probably be more people than we have questions, time for questions, but go for it. Yes, person at a microphone.
Hello there. Art, about 20 years ago, I saw you introduce Will Eisner as the father of the graphic novel. So, in the basement of Cooper Union. Uh-huh. And here you are switching chairs here.
Oh, yes.
How do you feel about that?
Well, I feel I'm the next to go, right? Like, you know, Will likes to tell the story that he came up with the phrase because he was trying to peddle a book of short stories for adults called
Contract with God.
Contract with God, thanks. And when the publisher said, but we don't publish comics, he says, it's not a comic, it's a graphic novel. And he said he was inspired by this man, Lind Ward, Lind Ward had done these books in the late 20s that were novels in woodcuts, and he said they made a very strong impression on him when he was a kid because they were being discussed very seriously in the book pages of the newspapers. They'd made a real sensation, and he was able to recall that, well, he can't call it a woodcut novel because he'd do it in pen and ink, but it could be a graphic novel, which was really good, although not completely true, in that there were comics fans at the time, serious comics fans, before that was possible because they all looked like the person in the left hand of the scientific diagram, who were saying, theoretically, it's possible for a comic book to be very serious. And they were talking about graphic stories and graphic novels. This is the one that inspired Will to remember the phrase, he says. But they were talking about Will's work as the clue that there might be serious comics, you see. The thing about this thing, though, is that God's Men didn't have any words in it. It was one picture on each right-hand page of a book, woodcut, that managed to get around basically a notion that came with the Enlightenment, where it was useful for citizens to learn how to read. You didn't just get to the age of reason when you were like Hansel, old enough to handle your father's axe and join him in the forest. Instead, it was important to learn how to read. And as a result, pictures got demoted. And that thing of like comics not for kids anymore, it had to do with the fact that kids had comics taken away from them because you had to learn to read without those pictures. Just they were training wheels until you got to the real culture. And that led to a kind of thinking that pictures have their domain, words have their domain. Words move in time because you hear them one at a time, and therefore that's the zone for epic poetry. Pictures can be emblems, but if they try to tell a story in many pictures, they're usurping the role of the word, of poetry. And this made comics trafe before they were invented, you know? And in a way, these woodcut novels basically circumvented that by making each picture a pregnant moment, a full image unto itself that happened to be followed by another full image that took place on its own but happened to move forward like only 3 minutes in time.
I think they were also hugely influenced by silent movies.
Absolutely. In fact, the person who invented the form, Franz Masuriel, was beloved by the German intellectuals of his time, Stephen Zweig and Hermann Hesse and Thomas Mann. And when Thomas Mann was asked what his favorite movie was, he cited Passionate Journey, which was Masuriel's woodcut novel.
But question over here.
Evening.
Yes, it is.
I just wanted to say to Art, I've got a bunch of personal friends who work over at Carmine Street Comics in the Village, in the corner of Carmine and Bleecker, obvious plug. So you have any advice for guys who are doing their own independent comics or doing their own work?
I actually have great advice. It was meant for a writer rather than for an artist, but maybe it's appropriate here, which is passed along to me just about 4 days ago while we were grousing about the New York Public Library losing all its books to New Jersey warehouses as real estate speculators want to gut the inside of the library. And he was talking about this letter that he'd found that Poe had written to a young writer. He found the manuscript of this right the year before he died. Poe was only 41 when he died. But his advice was, aspire. A literary reputation, it is true, is seldom worth much when attained. For by this time, the appetite for applause is sated. But in the struggle for its attainment is the true recompense. You're young, enthusiastic, and possess high talents. You will not fail of success. Be bold, read much, write much, publish little. keep aloof from the little wits and fear nothing. This was not a plant. This just happens to be in the notebook.
Oh.
Hi.
Yes.
Hi, Art. Hi, Neil. Thank you very much for your talk. Art, you did a great job talking about some of the choices you made designing pages of Mouse. Neil, my question was more for you. You were also talking about the surprise that comes from turning a page, which I really love the way you employed that in the Sandman series especially. And my favorite book that you do that in is Brief Lives. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit, when I think to myself, what's my favorite page in all of Sandman, and you're one of my favorite writers, I think of a page that you don't have a single word on, which is the page where Dream...
Morpheus goes home after having killed Orpheus.
Yeah, yeah, washing the blood off his... Yeah, so I was just wondering if you could talk a bit about that page, what it's like to write a page where your words are not going to be seen at all.
Well, okay, on a pragmatic level, any Sandman script was probably about 10,000 words long. Each issue of Sandman, I would write 10,000 words. The most words that would be appearing on a page would be about 180, maybe 200 words, actually in word balloons, and you had 24 pages. So the script was an iceberg. For me, the power of comics is the point where you can go silent. Yeah. What I miss most about writing novels is silent panels. Because in a comic, I can actually have a character stop talking for a moment and just have a beat, one of those black panels. And you can't do that in a novel. You have to say something. Even if you just say, he didn't say anything for a moment, you just said something, you broke that silence. And the glory of comics is, especially if things are happening in silence, then the reader brings herself to what's going on, to the image, and has to decide what's happening and how people feel. And I love that. So for me, just because I've written no dialogue underneath a panel description, it doesn't make it any more or less comics.
All those silent movies were written.
Yeah,
were hired
somebody
to write them, not just the intertitles. That's built in. And I think in writing comics in general, if you're, I'm looking at a lot of comics from the 1940s these days, and they're really primitive. Some of them, late 30s, early 40s, and what's really so like. The alien Arg leaped at him ferociously, or whatever the caption is, and then there's the alien Arg, and he's leaping at him ferociously, and it seems like one or the other might have been skipped, you know? And,
yeah.
And so good writing is really knowing how to deploy, in comics, means knowing how to deploy those images, you know?
Mm. You're using your words, you're using your pictures,
and actually, only recently am I mellowing in my old age, where I now can accept that comics could be written by one person and drawn by another. I used to think that was, I'd rather look at a badly drawn comic written by the person who drew it, or look at a comic that was about nothing, but boy, those women were beautiful. because at least it was a way into somebody's mind. But not in the field of comics, but elsewhere, I'm beginning to learn the joys of collaboration. It's something we were just talking about recently, that you really do create a group mind when you're working with somebody else, and that actually allows the work to be relieved of the pressure of the hothouse of your brain and allow you to enter into building something together. Yeah. You know?
Last couple of questions, because we are getting pushed for time. Yes.
Hello. Actually, Art, your response just now was actually something I was going to ask. I enjoyed the conversation format of this presentation so much that inspired this question. I made a realization today. I'm a grad student at SUNY New Paltz that my own writing in essays suffered because I would write in solitude. And so my question is now, what Oh, wow, I can't believe I'm totally spacing. But my question then is, how important is it in the writing process to collaborate and to interact with other writers?
Let me grab that for a bit and then toss it to Art. I love collaborating, and I love not collaborating. And I love having both, because there is nothing more glorious, having worked with a lot of other people, than to be able to stand up and go, right, you're all idiots, I'm doing it my way. And you go off and I'll write a novel or whatever and I'll do something, and it's like my thing and every word of it is mine and I'm proud. And then I normally look around and go, I haven't spoken to anybody in 11 months. And I'm starting to go stir crazy, and wouldn't it be nice to do something with other people? And suddenly you go off and you write a TV script, or you know, work on a comic, or just do something where you. One of the things I find is I can enjoy things that I collaborate on, because they're not 100% mine. I, much as an architect, could probably walk around a building he or she had designed and go, wow, what a beautiful building. Because other people have made it real. And for me, if I'm writing a script of some kind, or other people are going to have to turn that script into reality. And I will really, really enjoy working with them until the point where I go, actually, I want supreme power again. And then I go off into my room for 11 months.
Well, I found it very hard to collaborate in comics because I could never find anybody to draw it badly the way I wanted it drawn. And I wouldn't want to illustrate somebody's words because the drawing part doesn't... I wouldn't want to have to draw somebody else's stuff, because having tried one book as an illustrator, it was entertaining to set up the page layouts and designs for a book called The Wild Party with a poem I admired. But by the end of it, I was quite restless because I didn't want to have an argument with the person writing. So I was trying to enter into it as fully as I could from my place. And it made me grateful to go back to comics. And one of the nice things about collaborating is, what a relief. I can go back to doing my own things. But the collaborations usually have been in dance, in working with musicians now, and working with craftsmen who are working in another idiom, like... I made this large stained glass window, 8 feet high by 50 foot wide, for my old vocational art high school. And that was a pleasure because I could never enter into their degree of expertise. And I had to kind of work in collaboration, but I got to be driving. They were collaborating by reading the road maps for me or keeping the car mechanics functioning. But I was able to do the parts I wanted to do and have the surround apparatus and support system to let something get made I could have never made on my own. The only time I've really loved collaborating in comics was this thing called jamming, which is neither of you know where you're going. Usually it's just me not knowing where I'm going. And you just start making marks on paper, and bit by bit some kind of comics page grows out of it. And you're actually learning how somebody else draws by drawing next to them, you know? I got to do a comic strip with... there was going to be first an essay, then a conversation interview format, and became a comic strip that I did with Maurice Sendak that's around the web a lot now. Should you type both our names in, that'll come up within two hits or something. And there it was great because he never leaves his studio for his real work. And I figured I'd now planned this whole interview out. I just highlighted the parts that would have been the pull quotes in an article and said, that's the script. Planned it, invited him, and much to my shock, the old hermit of the woods came to my studio for 2 days. We sat together. Fortunately, he's left-handed and I'm right-handed, so we wouldn't bump into each other. And we got this thing done in record time. And it was really a giant pleasure for both of us because we were just discovering so much about what a work can be that's not from the same place as you'd work from yourself. And I'm very proud that after about 3 hours of listening to Mozart, I said, can we play some of my music? And I put on something called the Comedian Harmonists, which is an a cappella group from the 20s that I really love. And I listened to for 13 years while doing Mouse, because they were the best soundtrack I could find for doing it. And 8 of those years I did it through earphones, because my wife was going to divorce me, because she was hearing the same music all the time. But Sendak ended up loving it, and it opened up into the rest of my own record vault, and I had to make a mixtape for him as part of the price of working with him. It was great.
Last question. Hello.
Hi. It was really interesting to hear you guys talk about how much you were influenced by the old Mad magazines. My brothers and I were lucky enough to have a kind of trove left behind by my uncles of all the old, like, 50s and 60s magazines, and I always felt when I started reading Sandman that it kind of lends itself to rereading, because, like, every time I go through it again, I notice new details. So I'm wondering how much you were, like, consciously influenced by all the detail that, you know, comes to you through rereading the old Mads, and also how do you, like, work with the artists that you've worked with to make Sandman to kind of achieve the sort of density of detail that you have with this?
You put that amount of all of the information in a script. I mean, to answer the last question first, you write a script, you say page one, panel one, and you brain dump. You put it all in there. Gene Wolfe, who is a writer whom I admire enormously, said that defined good literature as that which can be read with pleasure by an educated reader and reread with increased pleasure. And I've always tried to do that wherever I can with anything that I write. And especially in a long work like Sandman, I love the idea that if you reread the comic, you would get more out of it. If you'd read the whole of that graphic novel's worth of book and went back to the beginning, you would get more out of it. And if you read Sandman all the way to the end and started again at the beginning again, you would get more out of it, that there would be things always to discover. And I also love the idea that, you know, if you come back to a book 5 years on, 10 years on, having got more out of life, having learned more, that the book that you come back to will not be the same one that you read before. And maybe you'll get more out of it. I know when I read the first part of Mouse, I was young. I was reading, you know, it in raw as it came out, and I read it as one thing, and then reading Mouse collected the full two volumes, doing a giant reread as you know, married with children, having a whole different life, it meant something completely different to me as a dialogue between a person and history, between a son and his father, between, you know, trying to examine what is history, what happened in the Holocaust, how can you talk about it, how can you talk about it as something that happened to one person, and it was a different thing.
Actually, I'm going to cannibalize part of the long introduction I did to that first book of experimental comics, Breakdowns. I did a section called Portrait of the Artist as a Young Blankety Blank. And in it, there were just these memories of things that had helped shape me. And I understand how my mother helped turn me into a cartoonist. And it was only then as a flash, remembering a moment where my father ripped a comic out of my hand and said, we're going away, I need to show you how to pack. And I turned that into a comic strip, and he was explaining how, you know, if you're ever in a position where you're going to have to run and flee, you want to have as much of your stuff with you as possible. So he was showing me how to fill a suitcase until it was bursting but didn't snap open, and would have every spare space, like the insides of the shoes can have socks, and then various other little tips as we went through. And I realized this was an important lesson for me as a cartoonist that I adapted afterwards, which was it has to be fully packed. You know, and that meant that there would be stuff to find when you went back, that each reading opens up other aspects of itself, because it's there as a compression of a fully experienced chunk of life. And that meant building it so it could float for a while.
Thanks.
We're out of time. Thank you all so very, very much. Art Spiegelman.